Hello, everybody. Hello, hello. Welcome to Letterform Lectures, online edition. My name is Grendel, and I'm Education Director at Letterform Archive, which is also the home of Type West, our School of Type Design. So, as usual, we have an international audience today, so please type in where you're coming from in the chat. And if you have questions, we'll save those for the end, so drop them in the Q&A. And upvote the ones you'd like to see answered. I'd like to give a massive shout out to Scylla Zaccolini, who's doing all the behind the scenes work to make this lecture series happen. Thank you, Scylla. Okay, folks, as you're rolling in, type where you're coming from in the chat. And you can also say what brought you here today. Why do you care about bastarda type?
Cool.
We are curious and we want to know. Okay, we're going to get rolling here. First, let me tell you about our current exhibition that's up in our gallery. If you happen to be in the Bay Area, come visit us. It features typographic messages of protest. This amazing and powerful exhibition of historical and contemporary political graphics was curated by Silas Monroe and Stephen Coles. And it's going to be up for a little while longer, so please come on by. And as part of the Strike Through exhibition, we're featuring some related workshops. And this fun political pin making workshop will get you ready to make a bold statement on election day and every day. So we are going to foil stamp and dry transfer and stencil and use whatever means we have at hand to get your hard hitting political slogans on a pin back button. Stick it to the man. Sign up for that now. That's an in-person workshop. And we have more lectures on the horizon. And our next one will be in person at the San Francisco Public Library's Corrett Auditorium. Hunter Saxony III, AKA the last Black calligrapher in San Francisco, will discuss his unique, amazing, and poignant calligraphic work and maybe even give us a live demo. Come on down. We're also thrilled to host renowned scholar and researcher Tasheka Arsenault Sutton, who will lead us through the brilliant works of Louise E. Jefferson, who is a Black woman cartographer, calligrapher, illustrator, graphic designer, and author, in our next online Letterform lecture. Okay. Letterform Archive is the home of Type West, which now offers online and in-person programs in 2023. Are you looking to expand your typographic toolbox? Are you interested in learning how to develop your own original typefaces, like Bastarda here? Have you always dreamed of starting your own type foundry? Or maybe you're a graphic designer who just wants to take your type skills to the next level. Consider applying to Type West. Our 2023 postgraduate program in type design is now offered both in person in San Francisco at Letterform Archive and online to students worldwide. Both programs are accepting applications through November 2nd. So our deadline is the Day of the Dead. Over three 10-week terms spread out throughout the year, you'll learn type design tools, technical skills, supplemented with type history and theory courses, specialized workshops in calligraphy, letter cutting, variable fonts, marketing skills, and more. So all our instructors are specialists and leaders in their fields, and they come from diverse backgrounds worldwide. And we all share your passion for type. So if you want to learn more about these programs and what we're looking for in an applicant, check our website. We're offering one full BIPOC and several need-based equity scholarships for each cohort. So please don't hesitate to apply no matter what your situation. And of course, if you have questions, don't hesitate to ask us anything. Our DMs are open, so slide on in. For more information about our upcoming Letterform lectures and our salon series and the workshops and events as they happen, go to letarc.org/events. Better yet, become a Letterform Archive member to help keep great lectures like this one today going. And finally, be sure to follow us on Instagram to stay on top of upcoming events and programs. Welcome to Letterform Lectures. Letterform Lectures are co-presented by the Letterform Archive and the San Francisco Main Library, Book Arts and Special Collections. Letterform Archive is a nonprofit institution housing over 90,000 works of graphic design history. Number keeps on going up. We are dedicated to the art and the craft of the letterform. We'd like to thank Adobe for generously sponsoring the video recording of this lecture series. You can view all Letterform lectures online. Soon after they happen, just check our website, letterformarchive.org. Main event. We're thrilled to welcome Seb de la Hoz and Jason Guzman of Bastarda Type, which is a Colombian foundry focusing on the typographic treatment of brand designs, logos, and custom fonts in editorial projects. The studio was founded in 2016, and they have been forming a new point of view on type design in Latin America since then. Okay, the foundry name Bastarda is, how should we say, a little peculiar. Whenever they say they are Bastarda, or they turn in an invoice that says Bastarda, they get a second look. So maybe they'll tell us how they came up with that name today. We'll see. Okay, folks, without further ado, let's welcome Bastarda Type.
Hi, hello, thank you. Thank you for the invitation. Here we are.
Hola, hola a todos. Muchas gracias por la invitación. Un gusto.
Yeah, right now we are in Marseille. It's 9 p.m. So yeah, we are very happy to be here. Let me know, should I share my screen now?
Go for it. And bienvenidos.
Thank you. Gracias, gracias. So I think, yeah, we have, do you see the logo?
Right. Yes, you're looking right. Good.
Okay, let me, yeah, cool. So let's start with this presentation. So we are going to talk about Salsa BT, which is a typeface we designed in our studio. And we are going to present ourselves for the start. So here is Jay.
Bueno, hola a todos. Muchas gracias de nuevo por la invitación. Mi nombre es Jason Guzmán. Soy diseñador gráfico hace aproximadamente 12 años. Y hace 6 años y medio estoy trabajando en tipografía de forma autodidacta. Y pues nada, llegué a la tipografía trabajando desde el branding, haciendo logotipos. Y ahí conocí a Sebas y como que nos enfocamos más en el diseño de tipografía. Entonces, los dejo con Sebas.
So, and I'm Sebastián, or Seb. I am a designer and I did my master's in typeface design in Reading a few years ago. So yeah, we are into type design since 2016, as Grendel says. We'd like to also to present Silvana to the left and Alejandro to the right, which are part of our team. We love to work with more people all the time. So this is kind of the closest team we have in the studio. Also Nayeli Jaraba to the left. We like to do some editorial projects with her. And also here you can see Ale Carruzzo, which is a Swiss guy, his student right now. And he was also involved in part of the Salsa BT typeface. So, well, my English is not so good or perfect. So if I say something that doesn't make sense or something, just let me know. And sometimes maybe I will use some words in Spanish. So hopefully you will enjoy this presentation. Regarding the studio, we have a foundry. We design our typefaces and we retail them in our webpage. We're going to release a new webpage in hopefully 1 month with some new features. So stay tuned to check the new webpage that we are going to launch. And we also have this other section, which is the branding section. We do some logotypes or the complete identity of brands. So we also have this in like this way of working in our studio, and that's what we call type branding. And we like to sell our design studio as a type branding studio. Let me know if the sound is okay, or should I speak a little bit louder?
You sound great.
Perfect. So yeah, please check our fund, our foundry. Salsa BT is free to download. So yeah, just check it and write to us if you want this typeface. And finally, we have a friend of us who's also, he lives in New York. He has better English than mine. So if you want to write us regarding any project, you can write to newyork@bastardatype.com. And yeah, he will answer with a better English than mine. Okay, so let's start with the story behind behind Salsa. This is a typeface that was born for pure fun. We were looking into this project that actually I saw something in the stand of Letterform Archive in Adobe Max about this work. So yeah, we were talking like in those days about this project that the Speakerman was involved in, and they were doing this revival of some typefaces that were pre-digital era. So we thought about it and we decided with Jay and with a friend of ours to do something with Salsa, because we really like music and we love salsa music. Hopefully some of you have the pleasure of dancing with someone or alone. So we were thinking about doing something with all these album covers from the 60s, 70s, that they are like very, in terms of typography, very interesting. So we were, yeah, looking to do something with this. Those are these images that you see here are part of the collection of Diego Ardila, which is our friend. He's into advertising, but he has a really nice and big collection of vinyls. So we were talking with him and we decided to do something regarding this type. These typefaces or this lettering that were used in those albums. So the decision that we take is that we were going to send some of our colleagues and friends those graphics, and they will interpret the word salsa from the typefaces that they saw in the covers. So this is one example that was made by Juan Kapka. Some of you, of course, may know him. So the outcome of this work, we show it in some lectures that we did in Bogota and also in Medellin. This is another example that we want to show you, because this is actually the first album cover that we have information that was designed by by Izzy Sanabria. No, not the first one from Izzy Sanabria, but the first one with members of La Fania, which was going to be La Fania. So this one was made by one of our friends, and he developed or he designed this text, taking the acid letter forms from this acid by Ray Barrett. And yeah, we'd like you to hear one of the main songs of this album. So this is salsa music for the ones that doesn't know about it. I believe most of the people hearing the talk know it about this rhythm. So that was part of some of the outcomes. We finally get 22 outcomes that we printed and show around the exhibition. Today we are going to talk more about the Salsa BT typeface, not about this part of the project, but more into the typeface. But these are some of the album covers that we use for that part of the project. And here you can see all the variety of colors and typefaces and grids and everything. So for us was very interesting. All of these are from Diego's Ardila collection. In the process, we also had this is kind of a little of deviation of the main focus, well, of the main topic of this lecture. But we want to show this because it's something, it's a new information that we have from this research. And when we saw these album covers, we were very interested in these logotypes, the stereo logotype that we see as kind of magnificent work. And we were looking like who designed this logo. So with Diego Ardila, we were looking into more albums to try to know which guys were involved in the design process. And we also checked that some other labels had also this kind of a stereo label in the covers, but they were all different, as you can see here on the bottom. So at the beginning, we were a little bit confused of why we have this kind of stereo logo here and other stereo logos there. But at the end, we found that all the labels at that time, they were doing their own kind of technical logos to put into the covers. It's this stereo is like let's say it's like a kind of new technology for the moment, for the time. It's like saying it was recorded in Blu-ray, for example, just to give you an example. So all this label has their own, but by doing a little bit more of this research, we found that the first album that we can see this logo is from the 65. And we really wanted to show this because we found that behind this design was a Colombian designer that we didn't know even that he existed. And he made a lot of, really nice work. So we check a little bit more, and the name of this guy is Eli Basael, which was a Barranquillero, a person who was born in Barranquilla, Colombia. And he moved to New York, and he actually worked and studied with Izzy Sanabria, which is the guy who we are going to talk next. So we have some links as well. The link will be shared in the chat. So, but And the link is from an interview that someone did to Eli Basael some years ago, and you can check more of information about him. We are really happy to have found this information. We may contact his family or something to know more about him and more about the work that he did in New York back in the 70s. So this is a little bit of new information that we found, and we like to share here. Okay, so going through this lecture, we present this first outcome, graphic outcome, and we put some music in Bogota and in Medellin, showing this part of the project. We also had a very nice introduction by Cesar Puertas talking about the geopolitics behind the Hispanic and Latin people in New York. So that part of the project was also really nice. We are going to talk about just a little bit more about these geographic and geopolitical issues from the moment right now in this presentation. And the guy behind this story is Izzy Sanabria. He was a Puerto Rican who moved to New York back in the 50s. So we have like some information about him, but many pictures, for example, this one or this one. He was a really, really, how you said that, Don Juan, like a Casanova for the moment. So yeah, I think if we want to design letters in a very Latin way, I think you should look like this guy who was kind of a bad guy, but really nice work. And we are very amazed about the work that he did in New York. And part of this project is to know a little bit more about this Hispanic designers that who did amazing work in the US. Mm-hmm. So here we said, and we like to continue with this term, the Nuyorican. I don't know if you have heard about this word before. It is used to refer to someone who was from Puerto Rico and who moves to New York, but also at that time they were using also this word to kind of to say the same as Spanglish. Back in the 70s, if you said also Nuyorican, some people refer to the way they were talking, which is like mixing Spanish and English, the same thing as we are doing today with my kind of pure English. So disculpas por eso, por el inglés si me falta alguna palabra, pero bueno. So Nuyorican was this term that was used in the 70s, and it also refers to the kind of to the fight or to the moment that these Hispanic communities were living in the US. Remember, this is the late 60s and 70s, beginning of the 70s, which is the civil rights movement years, that they are not only for the Black community, but also the Hispanic community organized and show like the things that they were care of. So also the Chicano movement, this Hispanic and Nuyorican movement was very strong at the time. This was the time that Nixon were running for office, and also the assassination of Martin Luther King. So this give you kind of a context of the moment that this salsa music was evolving in New York and in the US. Let me take some water, please. If I don't know if I can open the chat here, okay, but if there is any question in the chat, just let me know, some of you guys that are connected and can see the chat. This Nuyorican, we were saying that was only for Puerto Ricans who moved to New York, but at the end, the terms also speak about all this Hispanic community. I mean, also Colombia, Venezuela, and other countries from South America. And as you can see here, we see this little island, which is Puerto Rico. And Puerto Rico had a big, how you say, diaspora or movement of people that were moving to New York. And actually, we found that, well, the Hispanic community that was more big in New York is the Puerto Rican community, and the Cuban community was how you said that, the stronger, or yeah, I believe the word is stronger in Miami, in La Florida. So this is something that is particular because there is a lot of let's say fighting or como se dice eso, como there is a lot of words saying that the salsa music was generated in Cuba and not in Puerto Rico, but yeah, that we are not going to discuss which is the mainland of the salsa music. But the thing is that these two countries have a lot of things in common, but of course there is a lot of cultural disagreement with some things, and we can see here that their flags are very connected, like they are very close. So we want to say that as Hispanic, we are all together in the representation of our countries, mostly if we are talking about being in another country as an outsider. So by looking the work of Sanabria, we can see all this beautiful lettering that he was making at the moment, at the time. We can see all these letter forms and colors, which are very representative of Sanabria's work. Here we can see another of his portfolio. He did a lot of work. We are showing just some of the ones that give us more graphic base or background to develop the BT, the Salsa BT typeface. And here we can see that he was doing this kind of a couple, how you can say it, a couple, or I don't know the correct word, but he was in his design, he was doing this kind of understanding the letter forms and the outcome and the layers that he was drawing. So we can see that it was very into his work by doing this connection between some letters. Actually, the letter L in most of his work, he tries to put it very tight and very together with other letters. And he also had a particular use of the I with the dot, even in uppercase. So this was also interesting for us to see how he was doing and working with letter forms at the time. He also developed or founded this magazine, the Latin New York magazine. We also have one link that you can see in 2 minutes and 30 seconds all the covers of this magazine. in these magazines, he didn't use much of this lettering that we saw in the album covers, but it was a really impressive and really nice work, graphic work done by his team, him and his team. So, of course, if you found some of these magazines, just please take it and conserve it, because we found that there is a lot of graphic references and graphic design behind that. It's really worth it to have it. So there is another point that we want to show you, and it was the muse. I don't know if you can recognize the two guys here. Well, maybe because of the afro, now you can see who's Sanabria. But in the left, in the right, there is a guy who's making a signature in his t-shirt. This guy is Dalí, which we found was a very, very strong reference, graphic reference for Izzy Sanabria's work. And we found more images, and they actually met in several occasions. So we can say that this artistic movement and this artistic way of looking into design and commercial design was very important for him, and we can see some of that in the letter forms and in the way he was composing a piece. We have to remember again in the graphic landscape of the 60s and 70s that this was the time of the huge use of Helvetica and all these very sans typefaces, and at the same time, Sanabria was using and doing some lettering with more funkiness. Even though in both areas we see like a lot of color and a lot of expression with color, we can see that Sanabria was more into design the text with the image and not only with the straight typefaces. So this was this moment of very constructed, very clean design in some way. But we think that Sanabria was looking, or perhaps he has more or of a evolution of this graphic from the 60s, but bringing it into the 70s with a little bit more commercial look. This is something that we think is like that, but of course, there is no clear relation more of the graphics. So we think that for Sanabria, this movement was very important for him and for his work. So yeah, that's why we believe he developed those letter forms. And by looking to the album, that was the main step for us to begin the typefaces. The typeface was this album from the 72. Sorry, this was from the 72. And now we can see at this moment this kind of funky letter forms. We see also the text film and record, give us a little bit more information about how the typefaces and how the proportion should work in this typeface. However, then we found the volume 2. This one before was the volume 1 that was recorded in the Cheetah, which also has an amazing logo that you can see there. But then we found this Life 2, which is from the same year. They both were recording in the same night, I mean the same Life night, but they were released in different moments, both in the 72, but in different moments. But we can see that there is an evolution from the first volume to the second volume. And we can see that there are kind of a more like, or we see, or we think those are prettier forms from the second one that has more logic behind the shapes. So we take the volume two to start digging and to start to interpret some of the other letters that didn't exist at the moment. We can see here the iconic logo from La Fania. However, we found this wasn't the first time that we see this inclination or this kind of logo. The Fania group did exist before Izzy Sanabria, but as we can see here, they had a completely different logo. We don't have a complete information if this logo that we just saw, let me go back. We don't have enough information if Sanabria designed this logo, but in the information that Diego found, he found that the first time that this logo appears is in the 68 with this album cover, and Walter Vélez and Izzy Sanabria were involved in this design of this cover for this album. And maybe you found something, how you said that, algo que le recuerda, de pronto este logo le recuerda algo. No sé si con eso me entienden, pero this logo, you can see something from that period, and maybe it's because of this iconic logo from the Star Wars that also had this beautiful inclination. However, the logo, this cover, this poster cover, and the movie is from the 77. So of course they both are from the same period in aesthetics, but we can see that these guys from the record label were doing this beautiful inclination some years, almost 10 years before. Well, continuing with La Fania. La Fania was a salsa group, and it's called Fania All Stars because they were many artists who were recording outside La Fania and in the record label that was called also La Fania. And we think this guy here is Izzy Sanabria because of the afro again and the glasses, and because we know that he was in this trip as MC. The MC is the master of ceremony. That means the guy who has the microphone and present the band. That was something new for that time. And we know that actually Izzy Sanabria present the band in Japan in Japanese. So he was this kind of guy who really want to have the public feeling comfortable or in the family. I mean, so this is some this is a picture of the band, and just to say some of the big names behind La Fania is Tito Puente, Eddie Palmieri, Richie Ray, and some of these guys, they had their design, their covers designed by Izzy Sanabria. Bowie Cruz, Jimmy Sabater, Johnny Pacheco. Johnny Pacheco was actually one of the founders or the founder of La Fania. Ray Barreto, which was the one that we were talking about before about the acid by Ray Barreto. Larry Harlow, Will Colomb, and of course Celia Cruz, which, if I'm not wrong, was the only woman in the group. That was just to let you know some of the big names behind La Fania. But so looking back to this lettering, we start like trying to understand more of the letters. We did this adeno at the beginning, which was kind of a straightforward, no big leaps or interpretations here. but we start to put in some rules behind, for example, this bottom part of the letters. Now in the typeface are like a very strong feature in the proportions and in the way that the typeface is designed. So we set this bottom part of the letters as one of the main graphic characteristics of the font. But we also explored this inclination that the A brings to the rest of the letters. And this is the outcome, or this is the way that we found they will work better. Of course, for example, the W or the X are our interpretation. We really don't know how Sanabria will design those letter forms, but this is the way we thought where they were going to look nice. And we completed all this character with some other clips, for example, this percentage, or also this exclamation mark and the numbers, so the figures. So we explored this design through all the characters to give you a typeface that you could use in other text. And of course, we designed, for example, the et, el arroba, which we think it's very modern or contemporary, but we try to keep all this logic behind this glyph. So some of the glyphs are more personal in a way, and some are very close to Izzy Sanabria's original work. This is actually how the typeface is looking right now. We are using the font gauntlet by Dynamo, which is a very nice tool to use. And right now the typeface has all these diacritics to be used in other languages as well. And the arrows were designed by Ale Carruzzo, the Swiss guy who was working with, or who is working with us on also these geometric shapes and other signs and glyphs and symbols. We want to show you some changes that we have done to the typeface. Just let us know if you think those are right. In the left, we have the original version of the G, which now we think it is too busy in the counter. We think that there are too many things happening in the counter. And for this new release of this typeface, we changed that area. Let us know if you like this change, because this is one of the letters, because of the proportions and the shapes that Sanabria were doing, that was kind of difficult to understand if he will design it like this or not. So this is one of the changes that we did for the typeface. Here you can see it in some text, in some how you said that context. And we changed the spacing as well. We think maybe it's too tight now that I see it here. Okay, so another change that we did is the Z, or we don't feel that the one that was before, even though it has the same relation as the middle bar in the E, we think that maybe it's too far from this logic of the heavy bottom and top. So right now the new set is this one to the right, but we want to keep the one to the left as a stylistic set. So this is another change that we are doing now. We feel that the new one has this more close relation in shape to the other letters. So it's another thing that we wanted to show you. And some of the uses of Salsa are this one that we are going to show you. And Normally, we when we see the typeface in use is the moment that we decide to change things, because this is the real proof or the real test that people that doesn't know us are doing with the typeface, and then we can see that we can or explore new shapes or making some adjustment. This one is from Moises Baca. He's a Mexican guy who designed this packaging. This one is from a very close friend of us. He's Nicolas Galliano, and he designed this cover for a, I will describe them as a punk, soft punk band from Bogota. So here he also made an interpretation of salsa with a noise in the outline. We may develop this one as well. And this here we can see this package from La Polleria La Cosmica, which is a sandwich or hamburger, chicken hamburger in Bogota that used this typeface for the packaging. And here we can see some other uses from other places that, as I was saying, we really like to see how people is using it to make some improvements as well. And actually, we have this image that was sent to us. This is from a news channel, un noticiero, no sé cómo, news channel, that they were using the typeface to talk about some playlist in this program. So we are very happy of the use that people are doing with the typeface, but we really want to show you this that was made by Taliegleitzer, or I don't know how to pronounce it. These guys are from Israel, and they made not only the use of the salsa typeface, but they did some changes, as you can see in the counter of the letter A and O, that they didn't use the original one that was circular, but they changed it to this one, rectangular. So we decide to include it in a way to the new typeface. It's just a stylistic set that we can see only the change here in the counters by using this squarish counter. It also affects some letters, as the S and U, for example, that the counter is also rectangular. And we wanted to explore this based on the use that these guys did on the typeface. But we were also very atraídos, very into this kind of E, because that also reminds us the work that Sanabria were doing with the E in some of his work. So when we looked at this one and checking back to this typeface, we said, okay, we really need to explore a little bit more about this idea. So we finally decide to include this E with dot, which is a kind of a lowercase E composed in a uppercase only typeface, which we have to say that we really like it. So the idea here is that this typeface will be continue growing with the use that the people is implementing in the typeface. But we also see that if we were going to design this E with the dot, well, we maybe need to design this ligature that was very representative of Sanabria's sketches or design. So right now the typeface has this ligature. That right now is only working with the LE, which is the one that we just show you with the work of Sanabria, but we may look to other letters and other connections to explore a little bit more about this idea. So now with you, Nikita, which is going to present you a new feature, and Nikita is from Ukraine. So hi, Nikita, and this is your part. Just let me know when to change the slide, and hopefully you all enjoy the previous talk.
Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction. Yeah, I really enjoyed your lecture. It was so deep into the culture, and it tells a lot about how typeface is connected to the culture and the use of it. And we saw that in example of music. So even with the letter I, it's so connected with Ukrainian language, where we have the same I with the one dot and two dots. Even if you take a look at like typing of Ukraine in Ukrainian language, which is Ukraina, you will see two dots. So it's kind of symbolic that typeface connects to a global culture in this, even with this like E and with all of the use that you previously mentioned. So let's go to the next slide. Yeah. So of course, these are not as pretty like drawings that you saw before, but these were essentials to begin with. So the farther it is raw, the more exploration you can dive with or dive in, because me approaching this typeface tried to go to the far edges of its shapes to better understand and not only to imitate it, but try to think with it. And I based all of my exploration on existing typeface, which Bastarda Type kindly provided. So I started, so here's the full set of the Cyrillic alphabet. This is what most common one. And we have also Ukrainian alphabet symbols, which I will also show later on. So the idea was to put methodology in two approaches. The first one is to kind of analyze Cyrillic alphabet and apply it over existing letters and working only with existing set. And next, and we will start with the letter B. This is the second one in Cyrillic alphabet. And as you can see, I'm using the approach of using existing glyphs, which is B and six, numeral six, and I'm constructing new glyphs with them, which is the B and the soft sign. So the idea was to make the B, which is on the right here, more stable, which is first on the right, more stable. And compared to the numeral six, we see that the counter is a little bit higher and it has a little bit less space. This is for a reason, because you usually draw numerals a little bit narrower. And therefore I decided to make B a bit stronger and based of course shapes on the and proportions on the letters, but the shape itself based on a numeral. And let's go next. So as you can see, this is then an overlay of the counter placement and proportions of letter B. As you can see, I increased the upper dash a little bit over the curvature, the bottom curvature, and made it a little bit more stable with the drawing counter a little bit down. This you can find also in letter B if you analyze the typeface. And we can go next. So as you can see, these are the similar letters, and this is a common approach in type design where you use a modular kind of approach using one and applying to the next symbols. And so as you can see as well, I used the same approach with the spacing of the vertical in the middle symbol that also connects to the spacing in the typeface as well. So let's go next.
skip.
Okay, so here you can see that I took best of two worlds. So if you take a look at the Q, which is the first symbol on the left, I took a tail from it in order to draw in the far right, in two far right letters. But I needed something, I needed to fit it somehow, because in Cyrillic letters, you can find it looking bottomwards or to the bottom. So I needed to flip it to kind of fit in the same manner that it's already in typeface, but still recognizable. At the same time, you can see that I used square proportions and other letters proportion to kind of balance the counters, and following the idea with the thin dash in the E, as you seen before in the far right letter. Yeah, let's go next. So these are the counters and the negative space, just so you see the idea. The letter on the far right is a little bit smaller because we have this little tail on the right, which takes some space. So I thought about that and decreased the counter as well. Yeah, let's go next. Yeah, and this one was quite a challenge. This was the second letter I started with. And this on the left is letter A, and in the middle one is letter P, which is a Cyrillic letter I designed before. So this was kind of a multicultural marriage, I would say, because I took the best, of course, of two of those letters. So on the left, we had a diagonal, which I included in the letter L, which is on the far right. And I also took a proportions of that letter, which we can see on the next slide. Yeah, and as you can see, sometimes letter L, which is on the left, is designed as a square-based letter, as well as it also brings some heritage and guidance to letter D, which is the second one. And so together, they are kind of a family, which you should take all together to understand how it works. So we can go next. So these are the reasons I made them connected in a way. And as you can see, I decided to increase in the letter L the counter a little bit in order to bring some air, which we lack because we removing the little circle counter. So the idea was like proportion wise we on letter B, but shape wise we are using original letter A. Of course, bringing some calligraphical elements, because compared to the original salsa, A is kind of moving forward or has a very strong step, where letter L, Cyrillic letter L, has more of a pulling her leg to the right, which is a different type of, because you saw that in the previous slide where it was like a calligraphic. So I kind of tried to bring that serif more look to it. Yeah, let's go to the next slide. Yeah, as you can see, I also decided to put this calligraphical approach to letter D, which also had this swoosh or maybe a calligraphical curvature, and added a horizontal. The interesting detail is that you can have sometimes in letter D, you can have this downwards looking legs maybe, or even so they usually go down, but due to the fact that letter already had enough weight, I decided to keep it as is to kind of follow the overall color in the typeface, also taking into account that counter was locked. Let's go next. So on the right you can see Cyrillic letters Ch and U is simply, or U or U is simply a reflection of Y, because they have a quite similar, quite good similarities in the shapes, and usually U is drawn like that in Cyrillic alphabet. And on the left to it, you can see letter Chi, which has some kind of heritage from U and from letter V, particularly in the top counter and the bottom part. So again, using modularity to kind of design new symbols. Let's go next. Yeah, and I also was taking into account the thickness of lines and all of the measurements that were before in order to follow the existing rules. So all of the diagonals and all of the proportions were within existing laws of the typeface. Yeah, as you can see on this slide, I'm taking a new letter with the same idea of this calligraphical curvature, which you saw in letter L, and letter Ya, which is on the far right. It's not just a reflection of R, but also it follows this calligraphy approach. And when you're writing it with your hand, it has rather not a stepping leg, but a pulling leg as well. As in L. So yeah, as you can see in the following slide, let's go there. Yeah, the Ya like leg is a little bit, has a little bit curvature to it compared to letter R. Yeah, let's go next. The same approach of modularity used for the numeral 3 and letter Z or Z in Ukrainian alphabet. I added a little bit of diagonal on the right to kind of eliminate the confusion with the numeral 3. And also I decided the letter E on the far right, which both of them on the right correspond to the initial proportions that were set with a little heavier and more stronger fundament at the bottom and a little bit lighter top. And let's go next. So you can simply see an evolution of it. And the far right letter also will work as letter Y, which is just a reflection, simple reflection of it. Let's go next. Yeah, and this is letter U, which was quite a merging of a vertical and curvature. And if you take a look on the next slide, you will see that I'm decreasing a little bit the inner side of the circle in order to fit it well with the vertical. So the count or the inner space between the vertical and the circle would be, or like, the circular part of the letter O will be less, and it will not like cause gaps, and it will be even within the text. Yeah, let's go next. And this is like a compromise for me because in this, it would be harder a lot to follow the calligraphical approach for Cyrillic letters, for Cyrillic letter E. So I simply reflected N, and we can see why I did that in the following slide. Yeah, so as you can see, letter E is usually designed with the thin diagonal because its calligraphical order is different. So when you take a pen, you draw it with a thin side. So this is why I decided to just reflect it, because there were no, I didn't find a way to include this thin diagonal yet, maybe. Okay, yeah, and this is very simple. This is letter Z. I just included the vertical. This was, I explored, as you remember, in my first drawings, I explored some kind of variations, but this was one of the simplest and it works. Yeah, and sure. One of the final one is letter F. To me, it's like an elephant. So I using the same approach with a little bit narrower, with a little bit narrower circular part, so letter O, which you also can see in letter Q and other letters like G, and I'm merging them with the vertical. So altogether, it's also even proportion and color wise, it belongs more to letter M and N, which also have a pretty dark, like a darker color on the typeface. Yeah, and as you can see, this is how it looks when the original letter O overlaps. Yeah, let's go next. And this is a full set. You can take a look. This was quite an interesting exploration, and thank you, Bastard Da Type, for providing me this opportunity. This was such an amazing opportunity, an exploration of it. I didn't know how to thank you.
Super, super.
I don't know even.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We met with Nikita by Instagram and talking about typefaces and type design. So for us that we came from this Latin American country, Colombia, and doing a typeface with this Hispanic look for taking the reference and work from Izzy Sanabria is really nice to have you in the process, and we will develop this Cyrillic more to give you the typeface. We think that this release is going to be very soon, and actually we are working hard to do it with the new webpage that I was telling you at the beginning. So here is a text that says dance, because this is what we think is better for all of us now. Just dance and enjoy as much as we can. And we want you to show you that salsa is always evolving from all the work that people do. And we also have designed this Redonda version, which is going to be released again with the Cyrillic. So the new family will be Salsa BT Cyrillic, and this Redonda version of the typeface. More links right now are in the chat. More links are for Izzy Sanabria's work and other information in English and Spanish about the work that Izzy Sanabria was doing. But again, we are very happy to be here and to share you guys the work that we do in our studio. So danke schön, muchas gracias. We are very thank you with this invitation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Super. So yeah, thank you, Grendel.
Muchas gracias. Mil gracias, chicos. Super. Thank you, everybody, so much. We have a few minutes for questions.
Yes. So
if you haven't already put the questions in the Q&A, please, and also upvote any questions that you'd like to see answered in case we run out of time.
Super.
Can also aceptamos preguntas en español también. Entonces,
yes, super.
Yeah, no, well. No hay problema. So let's, what I'm going to do, I'll read you the questions, okay?
Okay, perfect.
Seb, Jason, and Nikita. And then I'll answer them I'll type in the answers as you answer them.
Okay.
So, primera pregunta. What Gianna asks, what was your process for finding good resources on Latin designers and artists?
Well, we have some archives that we like to dig into. One of those is the one of our friends, Juan Pablo Fajardo, who developed a archive of Colombian graphic design from the beginning of the 20th century. We can send you the link also here. But I think internet and these kind of archives are good spots to dig into.
That sounds awesome. Drop that link in the chat for everybody to check out. We have a question from Anonymous. Anonymous asks, creative ideas are constantly flowing from past and upcoming designers. Past works have also provided us with a spark of creativity. I wonder how you think typeface designers should approach their new projects. Have you ever worried if your work appears to be similar to that of other designers? How to develop these ideas from our research into a new take on design?
Of course. Well, you need to always be aware of that, how close you are to your references. In this case with Salsa, I think it was more how you said that in English?
En español, ¿cómo es?
En español sería como una no tengo la palabra, una...
Ni en español, how about Ukrainian? Go ahead.
In Ukrainian. It was more to show the work of someone that we didn't know some years ago. So that's why we are always showing this project with the work of the original designer. But I think it depends on that. What do you want at the end to show this kind of respect and bring into the digital era as a revival or taking advantage of some letter forms that you saw in your reference? I think it depends of how deep you are going to go with the reference. But if it's very close, I think it's going to be where to always show the original work and where does it come from.
So you would think of Salsa BT as more a revival. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, a revival. Yeah. That's why it started like that, as a revival of something that we saw from someone.
Okay, good. Let's see, Felipe asks, are the new letters that we voted on replacing the old ones, or are they going to be variations?
For the G and Z, yes, they are going to replace the 2008 ones. So if you already voted, it will be really nice to know if they change work, or should we keep the other ones? We are with this typeface, we are very open to all these kind of ideas and interpretations, and yeah, let me know if they work, but they are going to replace the old ones.
Well, definitely you'll have to check the chat later, because we did all vote on those. Cool. And feel free to keep adding to the chat, folks, if you have an opinion. Okay, Sandra says, hello, thank you for all that you have shared with us today. I believe I heard we can get the Salsa typeface, but I missed the part on the process. How do we go about either purchasing or downloading it?
Cool. So the typeface is free because, again, it's free because it's not an original work completely from us, and we want to spread the story behind. You can download it in our webpage at bastardotype.com. And right now, you click on the contact button in the typeface, but in the new webpage that we are going to release in 1 month, it's going to be automatically. But for now, you check your web and send us an email with the button in the typeface.
Okay, I think we got that. Thank you very much for sharing that with all of us too. I'm already scheming on how I'm going to use it. Okay, let's see. Gianna asks, are you going to continue your research and work on more typefaces?
Yeah, for sure, for sure. For us, these album covers are a very, very, how you said that, un terreno muy bien abonado, a very, very we can find very nice graphic elements there. So for sure, we are going to research more. And actually, maybe the second stage of this project will be knowing a little bit more of this Colombian designer who did this Etta James cover using this beautiful stereo logo. So for sure, the next step will be knowing a little bit more about this guy, about Basael, Mr. Basael, who actually he studied with Sanabrias, and they had the same age at the moment.
Super. Okay, I mean, what are you gonna say? No, we're done. No more typefaces.
Of course, yes.
Let's see. So Gianna asks, what was your favorite part of this project?
Well, listen to the music, listen to the albums. I think the good part of this project is that it's for fun, and we understand when we open this file that we can explore more freely the letter forms. So that will be the part we enjoy more, that interpretation and new letters and new ideas into the typeface.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. Let's see, we got more questions. They keep coming. We've got a few more minutes though, so it's all good. Renaud says, thank you and bravo for your amazing work and typeface. And then he says, check Izzy on this short movie. And he's provided a link. And he says, básicamente salsa. Renaud, cool. I don't think that's really a question, but maybe Seb and Jason have some comments anyway.
Yes, we checked. And we know that there is a movie. We understood that it's coming, but if it's already released, it will be much, much better. Though I think we put this link also in the links to share with you. But yes, please check the movie and please check more of his work.
Okay. Leonardo says, are you thinking of making salsa a variable font?
We thought about that, but we think we are going to explore more the color font with salsa, because salsa is all about color and this kind of flavor. So I think we're going to explore more about color fonts, or maybe variable color fonts. I don't know.
Variable color. Sure. Okay. Just go for it. Let's see. Trine. Trine, for ruining your name. Asks, does it include alternative characters like a mirrored A, like in the original work?
Which will be the mirror A in the original work? Let me see if I understand. Yeah.
Well, I understand. And from the album covers, there was one where the A was flipped on the album cover.
Let me see here. We are getting there.
Here, this one.
See? Ah, for sure.
Trini.
Let me write down that one. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It should be included, of course. It's part of this kind of original flavor of these covers that were done for the purpose of getting the attention. So for sure.
Okay, so you're going to get right on that case after this presentation is over. That is coming.
Reflects, yeah. So
love it.
I just write it down.
All right. Thank you, Trine, for the excellent suggestion, because I know we need that A. Okay, let's see. Manny Parra says, any inspiration from Discos Fuentes album covers?
Oof, that's nice. I imagine you are Colombian. Discos Fuentes is another label, but they work more in Colombia. I don't know if they had some other artists outside the country, but it will be very interesting to search and dig into. Yeah. Maybe we can found some archive about this.
Awesome. Let's look forward to those. Cool. Let's see, a couple more questions. Alex Garcia says, what is the salsa song that makes you guys dance more or inspires you the most? Two different ones.
Let's say we did a poster with I think the letter says Arepa con huevo. And I think, yeah, maybe that one, if we played in the studio, for sure, Jay and I will be dancing. So I don't know the name. Let me know, Alex, if the name of that song, maybe you know more, is the one that says Arepa con huevo me pidió al amanecer. Maybe, yeah, maybe that one will be the one.
Arepa con huevo. Yum. I'm getting hungry for lunch, right? Let's see. Patrick Ray. Is this the Pat Ray I know? Says, will you develop a family of salsa variations? In other words, light, bold, condensed, etc.
It will be nice to explore that new way of using salsa. Maybe if we have more time, we can try it. The doors are open for that. The only issue is the timing. But yes, it will be. Actually, the light one or extra light will be, I think, a nice feature in the salsa family. I would
awesome.
Say, yes, let me write down.
Yeah, write that one down too. You're getting some good tips from the studio audience. Hi, Pat. All right, last question, folks. Here we go. Yep. Pilar says, what is your favorite part of your design process of creating new typefaces? And maybe Nikita can weigh in as well, or not.
Cool, cool.
Nikita? Nikki?
Yeah, yeah. What's the favorite part of designing new typefaces?
Mm-hmm. Sure. And then them too.
Yeah, yeah. So on my end is probably the deconstruction. I really love to understand the laws behind the typefaces. Firstly, I usually categorize, explore, use my library that I have collected all there. And we actually talked a lot about it with Seb, and I showed some books and they shared them with me. So with this part of exploration is really interesting because you can connect with other people, for instance, or you rather go deeper in your knowledge where everything else lays. And this is so exploration for me is the most interesting part. But of course, you have to finalize the glyphs and details. It's mm-hmm. Sometimes it's boring.
Yeah, it's a lot of work.
Anything else to add to that, Seb or Jason, who has been lurking this whole time?
Jay went for the beers, so I'm waiting him for with the beers to celebrate the night. But yeah, for me, maybe it will be the use of the typeface. I don't know, because we are designers as well. We really like to use the typeface and to see how the designers are using the typefaces. So that's kind of one of my favorite parts, to feel the spirit of the typeface when it's released, something like that.
Awesome. Those are great and interesting answers to both those questions.
Gracias, Pilar.
Pilar just says gracias. And I have a question. ¿Por qué se llama bastarda type? Why are you called bastarda anyway?
Well, at the beginning, we were looking for a name that was kind of the energy and the way we look the design process from the Jay's corner and my side and my point of view, which is Jay's very experimental, very free, and I'm more into books and more academic and more into measure things. So I think bastarda as the bastardas from the Gothic style, they have a little bit of this, like a little bit of freedom and movement, and a little bit, of course, of beautiful use of the tool, of the inclination and the pattern and the rhythm. So I think Bastarda is kind of this relation between the way Jay works and the way I like to work. That's why we choose that name from the black letters Bastarda.
I was wondering if it had anything to do with the variety of black letter known as Bastard or Bastarda.
Yeah. Yes.
That's really cool. It relates to you guys too, which is really perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. I decided to wear a hoodie with some black letters today.
Oh, it's too small. Yeah. I can't see it on the screen. That's too small.
Yeah,
oh, I see. Wow. Love it.
And here on the back, it has.
Ah, nice. Yeah, we
are. So it's kind of a symbolism here.
I love it. No, Bataan is one of my favorite kinds of black letter. So just because it's that blend of the highbrow Gothic textura and then the more pedestrian or lowbrow or common Gothic cursive. Exactly. And it results in that unique bastard blend of those two. Bastard child.
That's the, yeah, that's the story behind it. Yeah. That's why we choose the name.
Okay, Bastarda. Thank you so much. Gracias, Seb, Jason, and Nikita, and everybody who joined us today for this fantastic Letterform lecture. Once again, please join us shortly for more Letterform lectures, either in person or online, and some workshops this fall as well. Please stay healthy and safe, my friends, and we'll see you soon. And don't forget, apply for Type West.
Cool. Thank you very much. And bye-bye. Muchas gracias.
Gracias. Adios. Ciao. Wow. Super fun, you guys.
Thank you. Ciao, Nikki.
You guys are great. Ciao.
Nice to meet you.
Okay. Yeah, bye-bye.
We'll talk later. Yeah.